we really mean is the time of rebirth that is happening in music after the artistic renaissance, which started in Italy a few centuries earlier. It was the time frame we covered last week. Now we're digging into the next time frame. We're looking at the 17th and the 18th century and how they contribute to sacred music. We're going to start tonight by looking back at the Renaissance as an artistic format and moving forward to see how music has its own rebirth. Let's go on to the next slide. So what happened from 1610 to 1750? The time frame that we're talking about here is the traditional time frame that would have been referred to as the Baroque. And what I am referring to it tonight, I'm referring to it as the Second Renaissance, the First Renaissance being the time frame in music history when Notre Dame Polyphony started in the 12th century. This is when we expanded from organum or music sung for multiple voices, and we're able to capitalize on that idea and to expand it and enhance it to a level of complexity that it went through the Renaissance period of the artistic Renaissance and grew into the choral mass, into the motet, and into the other different formats that we've discussed over the past few weeks. In this time frame, we are looking at the establishment of music firmly as both performance art and also as sacred worship. And what I mean by that is that up until this point, vocal music was seen as high culture, while instrumental music has been seen as a lower format. Now we see that finally changing. Instrumentalists come into their own and bring with them a level of artistic achievement, which changes the sound of music both in the sacred and the secular setting forever. Music as harmony. Music stops being a horizontal structure moving across in lines, but instead a vertical structure where we think of the notes on the page as working together in a different format. We see the established mass setting, which becomes the standard for the next 400 years. That's due to the Council of Trent and the changes made in the Counter-Reformation, the birth of the recognizable orchestra, new musical forms and international styles, particularly in Germany and Italy, and then a greater divide between Catholic and Protestant music, hence the difference between Italy and Germany. And this reflects a lot of the political turmoil happening during the time. We have the 30 Years' War and the massacre of the Huguenots, and we see throughout Europe a transformation as Europe struggles to find itself in its new thought process of two different kinds of Christianity at one time, no longer just the universal Catholic Church, but now Protestantism as well. And then we see the establishment of the colonies in North America, and their influence on music in a sacred setting. We'll dip our toes into that tonight, but most of our time is going to be spent on that next class period. Next slide, please. Go to the next slide.
Is it not moving?
It's not moving.
I have it on Why Does It Matter for me? Okay.
Oh, there it goes. Thank you so much.
Gotcha.
Why does it matter? So this is a time frame that we actually see a major change in music history. It's a time of growing pains. Oh, we're going to go back one slide. It's a time of growing pains. Music is going to take some huge leap forwards by incorporating musical instruments, and that's going to come into the sacred setting. And as small as of a thing as it might seem to us, okay, there's instruments, it's a huge step forward because it allows composers to work with instruments in an entirely different way, remembering that the church is still one of the largest patrons and gives the composers the ability through funds to be able to come up with new and creative ways of expanding musical repertoire. However, at the same time, through this divide, we are seeing that some styles of composition are limited and artistic choices may or may not be permitted. The Council of Trent is changing the Catholic thought process when it comes to music. It's trying to return things backwards, trying to go back to the early church with a focus on God, but it is the Protestant movement which opts to truly return to the simplicity of music as some prayer. Now, in previous classes, I have mentioned from my own personal background that I was raised in a fundamentalist Christian home, but I was always peeking in the window of Catholicism through my family and through the churches I've worked at over the years. I've loved, enjoyed, and relished my time spent in Mass and spent working within the Catholic setting. And so that allows me, I think, to kind of see things in a bit of a different way than a lot of other people. I'm seeing it from both perspectives. And I am going to show tonight a few of the positive perspectives that we're going to see from the Protestant background as well. There have been some contributions that definitely need to be addressed that have helped everybody when it comes to expressing Christianity in a way that allows us to worship fully and to glorify God without a lot of clutter. Let's move on to the next slide.
Just be aware, there's a bit of a delay. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Let's see if we, is it showing up? There it goes. Let's go ahead and switch straight to the next slide so we can catch the time up. Part one is for structural changes. And we can keep on moving on the slides. Structural changes, by the way, refer to the music theory. We are going to dip a little bit into music theory tonight. If we spend too much time on it, it becomes a scientific music, a music history class. And to be perfectly honest, you can get a music theory class at any community college for a few hundred dollars. The focus of this class is to understand the humanities of music, but taking a little bit of time to focus on the music history itself is a good thing. Let's take a look at the different planes first and foremost. Music has been up until this point horizontal. I take a chant line, I add another line on top of it, I add a third line on top of it, and I interweave these. I'll do that first line and then I'll put on the second one. Sounds great. Now I'll add a third line of music. They sound great as they move along together. I'll check to make sure that there aren't any pitches that clash, and I may have some additional rules of counterpoint that I'll be following. But in general, I'm thinking about three independent lines that are working together. That is an old way of thinking. It's a Renaissance way of thinking. It's a medieval way of thinking. It is not the way we think of music today. And it has a name. It's called point of imitation, meaning I'm going to start one line and it's going to be imitated by another line, imitated by another line. I take those different concepts, I put them together on top of a chant line, and I create that lovely sound that we get during the Renaissance, that wash of music that just covers our ears. And we do have a really great composer for this, for an example for this. I want us to spend some time thinking about this kind of music before we move on to what is going to happen next in our music renaissance known as the Baroque. So if we look at a composer who's perfect for this, it's Palestrina. He's a 16th century composer. He's very dedicated to his work in the Catholic Church. He's written masses, motets, all sorts of different things. Let's go ahead and flip over to the next slide so we can get ready a little bit early for this. And while we're thinking about Palestrina, it's important to remember that we are not looking at music as it pertains to what is this part, and this part doing at the same time. Instead, we're thinking, how are these lines working independently and how do they weave together? Almost like a rug. This is Palestrina, and this is a very beloved piece called Sequecervus. It is a perfect example. If you watch these four different lines of music, you can count them together on the screen. There's one, two, three, four. You can check by the text if you are not familiar with reading music. You can see that these lines are kind of doing their own thing. Let's give it a listen. Is the video coming up on your side? Slide. So the sound that you just heard, that wash of sound over us, that's created when we take those independent lines and we put them together and we have those lines kind of arching off of each other. When we get that sound, we know we're in the Renaissance, the artistic Renaissance, the Italian Renaissance, 1450 to 1600. We know we're in that time frame. Now, let's look in terms of different planes. Baroque is different. We're starting in the year 1610, roughly. As we've talked about in previous classes, there's never an exact year. Baroque, homophony, and monody. And actually, I'm sorry, let's go back. We should go back one slide, I think. We may have gone ahead two. Let's leave it right where it is, actually. So with Baroque, homophony, and monody, that's our next step. What's going to happen now is instead of composing music where we have different lines moving this way, we're now going to think of music this way. We did not have another slide in there. Go ahead and go ahead one forward. I have several different notes of music happening at one time. And I'm going to think about how those react to each other before I move on to the next set of notes and how they react to each other. And then I'm going to move on again. So my brain is thinking vertically at this point. It's thinking down, 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 or up, 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 up as we go across the page. Might seem simple, might seem silly, but that's a huge difference in the way we think of music. And people are going to change the way they write music once they realize they can think of it that way. So we're thinking instead of the group sound in mind. No longer are we just thinking about, oh, this person's voice and this person's voice and that person's voice. Now we're thinking about all the voices at one time. And again, all the voices at one time. And we're thinking about that whole sound and how it works. We are composing with the idea that these inner voices, these inner parts are going to be working together. And these outer parts are going to be working together, not a bottom and building up. It becomes an idea of thinking about the big picture of music, not these little individual lines, which are kind of more like the forest. The closest comparison, if I were to look at the Italian Renaissance when it comes to visual, is the way we thought about depth perception. Once they got depth perception, which they did actually back in the medieval time frame, but they really got depth perception in the Renaissance. That's when you see people like Leonardo da Vinci and their beautiful paintings with multiple levels of forest behind the main person. And you can see depth and distance into the backgrounds. Once they figured that out, they were able to run with it and able to create new masterpieces that allowed us to see it almost a 3D idea. And that's exactly what's going to happen here. This happened before Baroque as we know it. There's a composer named Gesualdo, who's a late Renaissance composer who's already playing with it. And there's also, if you look way back into the Ars Subtilior, which is the time frame before the Renaissance that we were talking about last week, all the way back to two class periods ago, Sicconia was also playing with these ideas as well. So with these different composers already kind of tinkering with the idea of thinking about these chunks, we find ourselves suddenly able to think of music in whole new ways. And that opens the door for instruments. Let's take a look at the next slide, because the next slide is going to show us a little bit about what Gesualdo is thinking about. Gesualdo is a late Renaissance composer. I'll be honest, he's my all-time favorite. As a composer, not as a person. Unfortunately, he felt that it was a good idea to murder his wife when he caught her with her lover. So not exactly the kind of person one would want to invite to dinner. However, his music is very interesting. This is one of his earlier pieces before he kind of tipped over the edge a bit. And even in this piece though, if you listen to it, you can hear he's thinking about more than one part. So we're looking at the video on the left. Let's go ahead and start with that one. To hear that piece of music today, I might almost think that somebody wrote that in the last 50 years. But no, it was written before the year 1610. Gesualdo is playing with the idea that those sounds all need to work together. They need to support the group. I believe there's an economic theory about that as well, that you need to be able to support the group in order for something to be able to work. So that means that there might be some lines that may not necessarily sound perfectly great independent on their own, but they're there for the support of the group. Now let's take a look at what that actually looks like in a picture format. If you look on the right side of this slide, that is what we're talking about. That is the idea of this new Baroque thought process of thinking vertically. If you notice, the notes are stacked on top of each other, and that is a name, it's called homophony. But more than that, it's the idea that these notes are working together. If you're a soprano, an alto, a tenor, and a bass, you all matter. And if one of you is missing, the entire sound is completely shifted, and it may not even be a happy or a sad sound anymore. It might be a different kind of sound altogether. Every single part matters, and they matter by thinking of them together, not as independent voices. Let's move on to the next slide. What we're going to do next is discuss how it is that this changes the way that we think about music and how we can add instruments into this sound working together. So let's see for the next slide. I apologize. I added in one extra slide I completely forgot about, and that is the point of imitation slide. I wanted you to see what it looks like if I compare the two of them. You just saw the tallest slide, the slide where I had the different lines stacked on top of each other. This is what it looked like beforehand. Take a look at these notes. As you can see, they're not together at all. This is a beautiful format of singing, and it allows the sound to just wash over you. But everybody's doing their own thing, and you can literally see it, even if you can't read music, just by noticing where the circles and the dots are. They're in different places versus being stacked right on top of each other. Let's go on to the next slide. Here, I show you what a music theorist would see. This is what somebody who actually goes back, for one slide, please. So, what does a person who's actually looking at music science see? Going forth one slide, please. Thanks. So what does a person who actually sees music theory, what do they see? This is a great example. It shows that the music has not only been stacked on top of itself, but it has a name. And we give it its name through that little Roman numeral at the bottom. What that's saying is that it's just the first set of sounds in the key of C, or the first chord in the key of C. The other sounds are all given additional names, and you can see those as well. But now this is how we're going to start thinking about music. Not I'm going to write a line and then write another one on top of it and then write another one on top of it. But instead, I'm going to think about how these notes stack on top of each other and the blend of sound they each create by themselves as a group, as each individual set of sounds. Let's move on to the next slide.
It's showing on mine, Katie, the different planes about Talus.
It's not showing on mine.
Oh, it's probably just a video
there
delay.
goes. There goes. We got it. So, the different planes. So, in the piece that I'm about to show you, we're going to talk about exactly how this whole thing works together. Polyphony is many voices at once. Homophony, many voices at once, but it's the same line structure. It's what we've just been talking about, thinking in terms of vertical. And then finally, the last one. If I take the idea of the different lines all blending together, that's our horizontal thinking, our vertical thinking, which is and then finally, if I take the two ideas, contrapuntally enlivened homophony, kind of mixing the two of them up. I have to give credit for that term. I'm not the one who came up with it. That's Dr. John Brobeck at the University of Arizona. But it's a brilliant idea that there's more than just two different kinds of music. The cool thing about this piece, we're going to look at a piece called If He Love Me by Thomas Tallis. He's a 16th century composer, and he includes all these different parts in one piece. It's an absolutely brilliant composition, and it allows us to get a full glimpse of what it is that you can hear in music if you're able to think in terms of music being this way and also music being this way. Let's go on to the next slide and click play. Get that opening into the meditation. All the way from here, horizontal. Together, but not quite. Me. We're going to come together right here. There's our new way of thinking, chords, homophony, breaking apart again into the old way of thinking. Ending in homophony. Let's go ahead and move on to the next slide. And I apologize, there's a little bit of a delay from when I see the slide. So hopefully I'm able to see it a little bit faster.
Yeah, as soon as you tell me to move on, it pops up. So if you have the slides on your own, then
It's taking a little bit of while. Ah, that's actually, if it's popping up right away, then.
Yeah, it pops up right away for me and for Marissa. So yeah, just have it on your own and then I'll follow along.
Perfect, that's great. Let's go ahead and do that then. So then we're going on to the next slides. This is other changes. So the other changes that are going to be happening are a little bit easier to understand. Number one, melismas. We're going to start adding long lines of embellished solo work. That means that somebody's going to sing very long lines that are meant to be very, very virtuosic. They're meant to show off. Then we're going to look at ornamentation. Ornamentation is meant to instead show off little tiny bits. It's meant to be decorative. It's meant to ornament like a Christmas tree. Trills, it adds a little bit of drama to the sound. Finally, we have word painting. Word painting basically allows us to see the idea of the that's being said in the text through the music. It expresses a feeling or an action. And then we have basso continuo. This is the use of lower stringed instruments or chordal instruments that are underneath the rest of the music and create an underlying sound. To get started, let's take a look at melisma. Now, I'll be honest, these are all Messiah. These are all going to be from Messiah. It is early November. My Christmas tree is up. because it's 2020 and it's Messiah time as far as I'm concerned. So we are going to go into the direction of Messiah, which P.S. it's actually an Easter oratorio, but everybody does it during this time of the year. And that's wonderful. So let's do a click on it and listen to a melisma, a long line. It should be noted, those are very hard to sing. Take a lot of breath, a lot of support, a lot of training, and they're not easy. They're meant to really show off the fact that a singer knows what they're doing. And that's another thing that's going to be happening during this time frame. The wealthy can afford it, and there are trained singers who can perform it. So we definitely include it. On the next slide, we have two additional different pieces that I wanted to show you. The first one is going to show a little bit of word painting. Unfortunately, it's hard to see it without the video, but I'll go ahead and tell you what the text is saying. It's, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way." And as we listen to that text, you're going to hear the sheep turning around and bumping into each other through the sounds of the different voices in the choir. Let's go ahead and take a listen. Another thing we're going to look at is ornamentation. Ornamentation is when we add on trills or other things to prolong the sound, perhaps even to prolong the suspense within the sound. This is very Baroque. You hear this so many times throughout Baroque music. This is perfectly in line with everything that was liked at the time. And even within the church, this stylistic choice was made everywhere. Let's take a listen. This is the video on the right. And then finally, we're going to take a look at this last example. This last example shows us what basso continuo looks like. Basso continuo is when I take a low stringed instrument or an organ or any kind of a harpsichord sounding instrument, and I use that to sort of prop up everything that's happening above it. It becomes the glue that holds it together. It also highlights the most important note within what we now call the chord. This is the part of the music that matters the most and tells us where the music is going to be going. Let's listen to the basso continuo at the bottom of this example. Here we go. So that has a video on it. So you just want to click on that video. Thank you. If you listen very carefully, underneath at the very bottom, you hear the low cello and you can hear the harpsichord. The harpsichord is a sound that really tends to be affiliated with this time frame, and its purpose is to glue together the sound. It is part of that basso continuo. Its job is to kind of keep things moving underneath so that we always know how the chords and how the music are going to work together. Part two, changes and additions. We have some new parts of music that are going to be added together into everything that we've done. Let's move on to the next slide, and we're going to take a look at opera. Opera, we are not going to focus on too much, but it needs to be discussed because it does exist. It's here, and it's definitely part of this whole experience. And the reason being is, if it hadn't been for the development of opera, we wouldn't see a lot of the development of interest in using musical instruments in sacred music. In Florence, there were a group of intellectuals who got together and decided to discuss together how they could bring some of the ideas of ancient Greeks back into modern living. They met primarily between 1573 and 1582, and they called themselves the Florentine Camerata. One of them was actually the father of Galileo. This was a group of intellectuals who felt that the only way to live in an enlightened way was to emulate the ancient Greeks. The Greek tragedies or Greek plays, Greek dramas, all had choruses along with action, and they wanted to put music to this idea. These were already starting to happen anyway in places like Mantua and other places in Italy, where the Greeks were, where the idea of using expression was already being put together in, as a madrigal or as an expressive format of music that was often used for love songs. But in this case, they decided to add musical accompaniment through the use of instruments. And here we have multiple different things that are developed. We have the recitativo. The recitativo is when we start speaking freely while also singing at the same time. We have the accompanied, where we have the orchestra sing with it, and the secco, where it goes by itself or has a little bit of accompaniment underneath it from the harpsichord. These are so important because we will use these throughout sacred music for the next several hundred years. We also have monody. Monody is a huge concept. Monody basically means a solo voice accompanied by stuff. And if we put that together, that's pretty much every solo work or anything that we're going to see in opera and in lots of pieces of sacred music, including solos. So let's take a listen first off in the opera. This is what one of the very first operas, Orfeo et Euridice by Monteverdi, looked like on period instruments.
Ricordo boschi ombrosi, dei miei lunghi aspri tormenti, quando i sassi e i miei lamenti rispondean fatti pietosi. Vi ricordo boschi ombrosi, ti ricordo boschi ombrosi.
And we can stop it there. If you have a chance to listen to that recording, it'll get really stuck in your head. The cantata, that's our next slide. Cantata is another format that's been developed. Cantata is a questionable format. It's a shapeshifter. It basically means it is a song that is accompanied. It can be accompanied for single voice. It can be an accompaniment with the choir. It can be independent. It can be in a church service. It can be secular. It can be sacred. It can be literally anything. Now, I do apologize. I am currently in an office in my school, and unfortunately the janitor is doing some vacuuming outside, so hopefully they don't hear too much sound. So with the cantata, it is used because it can be just about anything. It's used in sacred settings and in choral masses throughout this time frame. This is a sacred cantata, and it uses orchestra, it uses choir, and it uses this idea of being able to fit anywhere within a sacred setting. Let's go ahead and take a listen. About this particular cantata is that it actually functions almost like a motet. We've talked about motets in the past, and one of the things that we need to know about the motet is that it was built on a pre-existing piece of music. These we've known for a long time. This cantata is built on a pre-existing piece of music too. It's built on a piece of music written by Martin Luther, and Bach uses this and puts it together in this piece of music and kind of creates the music around it, very much the way the motet did. So a cantata really can be anything. It can even be using the same format as a motet. It's confusing, this strange anything catch-all category, but it does exist. Let's go to the next slide. Of all of the aspects of this time frame, the oratorio is probably the most affiliated with the sacred stage music. And by sacred, I mean anything that's going to be involving any kind of sacred setting, Catholic or Protestant. And by staged, I simply mean it's put together and it tells a story, but it actually has no acting. It is technically an unstaged performance. It does tell a story. It does have characters, but they simply stand. And they sing out what is happening. The most well-known oratorio is, of course, Messiah. And beyond that, if you want to think about what an oratorio might look like, a really good example is actually Les Mis, the musical. It just is everybody standing in front of a microphone. Same idea. This uses monody, polyphony, and homophony. It uses the idea of a person singing with stuff underneath it. It uses the idea of multiple voices singing together, and it uses the idea of people singing in a choral setting where we're all doing that vertical set thought process. Everything is put together in this. It's really popular during Lent because you're not allowed to do any kind of stage performances like opera during that time frame. So it was developed out of that idea of you could instead go to see something sacred during Lent. And it originally derived from a musical service that was actually held in a church setting, but not in the main part of the building, built off to the side, because it was seen as a little bit too secular for the church originally. This is part of an oratorio. And although, of course, it's tempting to do Messiah, I did choose to go with something different. Instead, this is an oratorio by Vivaldi. And let's play the video.
Furore, socce, barbari, furie, 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 venite a nos. Armate, face, sangue, audace, cor regno squallido. Armate! pallido, fermate face tamuemus, furoris ance barbari. Furoris ance barbari, furie, 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 armate.
As you can tell, it's extremely difficult. It's also very entertaining and very engaging. And it's that aspect which makes an oratorio so special. This is sacred. It's unstaged, but it's still a performance, and it definitely engages the audience. Let's move on to the next slide. The Tridentine Mass, or known as the traditional Latin Mass, the TLM. If you worked in the Catholic Church between 1570 and 1962, you were using this liturgical format. You were using the streamlined missal that was basically created after the Counter-Reformation as a response to many of the complaints about the traditions that had been held in the Catholic Church throughout the 15th and 16th centuries. It was promulgated by Pope Pius V, and through a papal bull, he basically required that the missal be streamlined and limited to anything, any kind of rites that were only older than 200 years. So it had to have been beyond 200 years older. If it was something newer than that, it was not necessarily something that could be in Tridentine. It had to be something that had a true lengthy tradition, a reason for why it was there. Now we're running short on time. I'm not going to go ahead and show that video to you today because it, more than anything else, it simply shows you what the Mass used to look like. But I strongly recommend that you take a look at the TLM and see what the Mass used to look like before 1962 and compare it to our experiences today, just that we can see where we have again streamlined and what we have changed since Vatican II. Let's go on to part three. These are our composers. This is our next slide. And then we're going to go on one more slide. Sorry about that. One more slide beyond that. I apologize. One of my old slides managed to sneak in. Let's take a look at the different composers that have mattered to our time frame that we've talked about tonight. First off, the early Baroque composers, 1610 to 1650. The first one we want to discuss is Gabrielli. He was almost entirely located in Venice. And he was known for use of extreme dynamics. He could do the louds and the softs. And it was a huge, huge performance when Gabrielli's pieces were performed either in the sacred setting or also in secular settings. He primarily focused within the sacred setting, and he loved to use the physical space at San Marco, the church where he worked, to create contrasting sounds. It was a very unusually shaped church. And so he would put people in two different groups and possibly even three groups, and he would have them almost perform at each other. And it created this wonderful cacophony of sound. He expanded. He used instruments. He used trumpets all the time. He used choral pieces. He had parts for up to 12 different voices. That's a lot of stuff happening at one time. And he taught people, he trained people, he trained future composers, carrying those ideas into the future in other areas of Europe. Monteverdi, if we're going to give one composer the credit for creating a new Renaissance, it's probably going to go to Monteverdi, because he was the first one to think to actually write it down in a book and publish it. He wrote a book called the Secunda Practica. The Secunda Practica meaning the new or the second practice, where he talked about everything I discussed earlier this evening, the idea of lines being this way, horizontal, and now thinking of music this way. And he wrote music that was both sacred and secular. He wrote in every genre, and he was the one who pushed us forward into this idea of using orchestra and choir together. He's working at the same time as Gabrielli, but he's most famous for his Vespers of 1610, where he really started to explore this idea. Let's go on to the next slide. And again, for time's sake, we're a little bit behind. I'm going to have us listen to Monteverdi. And that is the one that is on the right-hand side of the slide. So if we'll listen to that video, please. That should be on the left side. Let's go with the other one.
Apologies.
So we've gone from, that was Gabrielli, so we did get a little taste of it. Let's move on to Monteverdi. compare that, at this point in 1610, it was just a few decades earlier that Palestrina was writing his music. It's a huge difference. It's adding an orchestra, it's adding in more voices, it's allowing the orchestra to have parts that are written specifically for them as solo pieces in a sacred setting where musical instruments were never allowed before. Here the church is finally opening up to them. Let's go on to the middle Baroque composers. These are the composers from 1650 to about 1725. Vivaldi. Vivaldi is famous for absolutely stunning music. Also located primarily in Venice, he was known as the Red Priest because he had red hair. He was a composer who worked most famously as a priest for the Pieta School of Abandoned Children. He worked primarily with girls' choruses and with girls' strings programs. It was a way to help make these women more attractive as they grew up towards being married into wealthy families. It was a trend to marry one of the beautiful or one of the very talented string or choral performers from this particular school. Not that every single child there was also very attractive, but at the same time, it was considered quite the in thing to do. What's amazing about his music is that it still resonates with us so well today. His melodic lines are just stunning, and it really makes us leap and jump when we hear his Four Seasons. He wrote a lot of sacred music. We tend to know the Four Seasons most, but his Gloria is a great example of his sacred works. Schütz. We tend to forget about Schütz all the time. We think about Vivaldi and Bach and Handel. We don't think about Schütz. Schütz was in Germany. Schütz is a Protestant. However, he's the most influential composer before Bach. He studies with Gabrielli. He understands the idea of how music is working within the mass setting. And he takes Gabrielli's idea of having all those different parts and he creates the idea of the double choir, which only extends how much choir we can have. He also really works with the basso continuo to make it very, very elaborate. And that later in life for us as people who like music is going to turn into the cello lines and the lower, the viola lines and anything lower in the orchestra, the bassoons, the double basses, anything sitting lower, it's going to become that. So let's move on to the next slide and let's take a look at two recordings here. The first one comes to us from Vivaldi and the second one from Schütz. So let's go ahead and click on the first one. Thank you. One of the most amazing things about that particular piece of music is that you can hear everything we've talked about. All these new styles, all these new ideas. You can hear the polyphony, you can hear the homophony, you can hear everything within that piece. You can hear the basso continuo banging away at the bottom. But what also should be noted is that this is a piece of music that was written originally for girls to sing. Women would actually sing the low parts. There were women within the Pieta school that were trained to sing lower, and they would sing those lower parts. This was not originally meant to be a piece for soprano, alto, tenor, bass with men. Unlike all the other choral pieces we've done in the past, where it's always been about boys singing high, this time it's about girls singing low. I'm going to go ahead and skip over Schütz for just a moment, and we're going to move into the late Baroque composers because, again, we're a bit short on time. Let's go to the late Baroque composers. That way we can dip a little bit into Bach and Handel. Bach, J.S. Bach, 1685 to 1750, Germany. He is probably the most well-known of the names that we're going to look at today, and he's primarily known for his sacred music for Lutheran and Catholic churches in Germany. He's an organist, a prolific composer, also prolific father, 21 children, a father of the modern music as we see it today. When we say that, what we mean is when we write music today, we write music using a long list of rules about what we can and cannot do. And those rules pretty much date back to Bach. They date back to what he did naturally, just trying to create sounds that he liked. Over the years, we've analyzed those things that he was just doing by choice and created them into rules that we follow in music. His use of choral and orchestra in choral and in sacred settings is prolific. He uses both. He was working for several very wealthy churches, including in Leipzig. And with the opportunities of those wealthy churches came the ability to use large orchestral settings. He's very familiar with ancient traditions. He understands chant. He understands how they work. And he is used to figures such as canon and fugue, rounds, and also fugue. A fugue is when you start a musical idea and then it's passed on to another voice part and then passed on to another voice part. It's kind of like point of imitation, but much more specific. And he loved using these. He would write them into his both Catholic and Protestant church services. Most famously is his Mass in B minor. Interestingly enough, it's a conglomerate. It's a bunch of pieces that he put together. There's a Kyrie and a Gloria and everything else you'd think you'd find in a Mass. Well, he wrote them independently and then kind of later we smushed them together and they became Bach's Mass in B minor. It's a beautiful piece of music, massive, extremely long, but at the same time, a true artistic wonder. Handel, notice his dates, pretty similar to Bach, 1685 to 1759, but he, despite being born in Germany, spent most of his time in England. He did study in the Italian style, but he primarily composed in England, and he worked with large orchestral and choral works. He did both sacred and secular, including opera, and he was the world's greatest procrastinator, as far as we're all concerned. Messiah was written in a record 42 days. Because he had been given an entire year to write it and procrastinated until the very end. And the interesting thing about Messiah is that most of the music in Messiah is actually just lifted from something else that he put together at some other point in his life. You can go back and listen to the Italian cantatas of Handel and hear choruses from Messiah blaring at you. You may be a little bit frustrated, but it is also very amusing to see that even the procrastinators of the world still manage to create some epic art. So let's take a listen to Bach and to Handel. Let's first take a listen to the piece on the left. That should be the Handel, if I remember correctly. No, I'd say that the Bach, if I remember correctly. The Bach should be on the left. Let's take a listen. Let's go ahead. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead and keep on playing if we can. And now that we've heard a little bit of Bach, let's real quick take a dip into Handel.
Dixit, 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 Dix
It's a far cry from where we were before. Suddenly, the orchestra is actually the most important thing that's happening, and that's quite different. Just even 100 years ago, vocal was the only way to be cultured and the only way to show any kind of real respect within a sacred setting. And now, take a listen to this incredible cacophony of sound that we're getting from the orchestra. It's amazing what all we're hearing. And the orchestra itself is growing. It's not just a few small instruments as it was when it began. After all, originally, it was just supposed to be for a couple voices. But now, it's actually quite large. And there's percussion, and there's different kinds of sounds. There's woodwinds, and there's strings. There's flutes. There's all sorts of different expression that's happening. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And as it continues to grow, the emphasis becomes using what we know of as the mass setting more as a skeletal frame on which to hang the art versus the other way around. In a way, we've now once again come to the problem of the Council of Trent. We're not using music as it originally was intended, at least not in the sacred setting. We're not using music as a way of worshiping God. Instead, the focus is on the art. So, next slide tells us about who is responding this way, though. Puritanical America. Let's skip down one more slide. This is the far opposite side of religious music. There are two elements we need to know about, hymn and psalm. What is happening in these elements? We've stripped away music of its humanistic aspects when we look at Puritanical America. These are the most austere reformers of the Protestant movement. Basically, what we have here are the people that were looking for the most simplistic form of worship, the most simplistic form of any kind of interaction with God. They believed that anything that they were seeing here when it comes to additional sound is simply vanity of this world, secular and absolutely unnecessary for the worship of God. Also, the idea of speaking in a language other than the language that you would already speak is absolutely heresy in their mind, because English is the language, or German, because they're primarily English and German. English and German are the languages they already would have heard every single day. So they would want to have interaction with God on this particular level. The responsorial style is what they're using. Basically, what happens is the leader sings something and the congregation responds. Very simple. We saw this hundreds of years ago in the church, and now we're seeing it again in the Puritan worship service. These early sounds became early Christian hymns. After a while, they started incorporating songs that were around them at the time, even incorporating some songs from the Lutheran aspects of Protestantism, because remember, these are Puritans. They're Calvinists. They are not Lutherans. So there is still, even within the realm of Protestantism, there are these additional breaks that are happening. These particular songs, they borrow from a couple of Lutheran pieces, but these songs go with them across the ocean to North America. The Puritans and the Separatists take their music with them. And as they build their new churches in the new colonies, they keep these very extreme Calvinistic viewpoints and these very simplistic sounds with them. And it is these sounds that create the original music of early America as we know it today. Let's go ahead and go down one slide and take a listen to what that would have sounded like.
Why do the restless nations madly rage? What haughty schemes are they in vain contriving? The kings and rulers of the earth engage in rash attempts to plot their empty striving. They stand prepared, they all conspire together against the Lord and his anointed King. Let us, they say, tear loose and break their fetters, cast off their chains, their shackles from us flee.
Thank you. If you listen to that, and if you take away the rhythm, if you were imagining that with just one voice singing, you'd almost swear you were hearing chant again. Just a chant that's got a really choppy rhythm to go with it. It's that rhythm that's coming to them from the time frame. They're still being influenced by the rhythms of the 16th century, and they are going to use those rhythms. That being said, it's much more simplistic and it's in their own language. It's interesting how they've taken this huge step back while the rest of the world is using music to expand. They're taking the step away. Let's go on to our next slide and talk about how this is going to affect us in our class. Next time, we're going to talk about the rise of the enlightened despots in Europe and the grandiosity of the music that was composed for the ultra wealthy. There are some palaces that were absolutely massive. And of course, they had their own court chapels. And of course, they expected massive amounts of music to be performed in them. These were performed as signs of wealth more than anything else. And they're gradually affiliated more and more with the non-religious life, despite the fact that they are sacred Catholic music. While we dig into this, we'll dig into Gluck, Lully, Haydn, Mozart. At the same time, we're going to continue to look at the music in North America and the music of the colonies and the Spanish territories, such as the music coming up north through the missions, even what we can find here in Arizona. So next time, the focus will be not on one continent, but on two, as sacred music makes additional changes and continues to evolve in a way that suits the needs of the time. Thank you so much.